My dear students, today we will start a new chapter, that is chapter number 7, Protecting Plants and Animals. In this chapter, we are going to learn the interdependence between plants and animals, and we will also learn human beings depend on animals and plants. So first of all, we have to know what is the meaning of interdependence. So, the way all living things depend on each other is known as the interdependence. No plant or animal lives alone. Each depends in some way upon other plants or on animals for energy in order to live, grow and to reproduce. Now look at the picture. So, as we all know, cow exhale carbon dioxide and trees, they use the carbon dioxide to produce their food with the help of chlorophyll and sunlight. Isn't we already know that process is known as photosynthesis? And what happens next? The animals, they also eat the plants. And trees also give us oxygen. So what is happening? The plants and the animals, they both are dependable on each other, and this relationship is known as interdependence. Next, we will learn that who are the producers. Producers means they can produce or they can make their own food. So, they use energy from the sunlight to turn raw materials into food by the process of photosynthesis. So can you guess who are the producers? Yes, they are plants. Next, we will learn about the consumers. So the meaning of consumer is the organisms who eat something or use something that is produced by another organism because of they cannot make their own food. Remember this one point, that consumers cannot make their own food. So they feed directly or indirectly on producers for food and energy. Consumers need to eat their food to get energy. So all the animals, they are consumers, like the bee, the snake or squirrel, owl, everyone. So we can classify animals on the basis of their food habit, or we can say we can classify animals by what they eat. Okay, so there are four types of consumers. Okay, or four types of animals are there. I have mentioned they are consumers because none of them can produce their own food. And we will find out that they are directly or indirectly dependable on the producers. Next is herbivore. Animals that eat only plants are known as herbivores. For example, cow, sheep, goat, elephant and deer. They are also known as primary consumers. I will tell you about primary consumers when I will explain the food chain. Next is carnivore. So the flesh-eating animals are known as the carnivores. For example, lion, tiger, etc. And some birds are also carnivores, like eagle or the vulture. Next is the omnivore. So the animals that eat both plants and animal flesh are known as omnivorous animals. So the meaning of omni is all. Okay, that is why they eat both the plants as well as the animals. And the example of omnivores are human beings, crow, even catfish and ant, they are also the omnivorous animals. Next is decomposers. Decomposers feed on dead plants and animals. They decay, that means they break down the dead matter and release minerals in the environment, which is absorbed by the plants. So the example of decomposers are bacteria and fungi. I have already mentioned that plants are the producers. So who are the primary consumers? Primary consumers are the herbivore. Do you know why? Because of they only eat the producers. That means they only eat plants. So the herbivores, they are the primary consumers. Now, who are the secondary consumers? Remember, secondary consumers will eat only the primary consumers for energy. That means the animals who eat herbivores, they are known as the secondary consumers. Now tell me, who eat the herbivores? Yes, they are the carnivores. They are also known as meat eaters. They eat the primary consumers or the vegetarians. That is why they are known as the secondary consumers. Look at here. The process of eating one organism by the other and getting eaten by another organism is called the food chain. Look at here. So, grass is the producer. Of course, it can produce its own food. And grasshopper eats the grass. That means the grasshopper is the primary consumer. Then the frog eats the grasshopper. That means the frog is the secondary consumer. And there are also tertiary consumer and the final consumers. So the food chain shows us how nutrient and energy is passed from one organism to another. Do you remember the decomposers? They eat the dead and decaying parts of all the other consumers. And plant also absorb the nutrients and the minerals that is produced by the decomposers. I hope now it is clear to you that plants and animals are dependable on each other. Let us find out that how animals are dependable on plants. Human beings also depend on plants because plants provide us food like vegetable, fruits, cereals and also oil and nuts. They also provide us many medicines like aloe vera, tulsi, neem, etc. We also get cotton, paper, rubber, timber, etc. from the plants. Plants provide us oxygen. Without oxygen, we cannot live and also take in carbon dioxide. Plants also depend on animals. Let us find out. Animals release carbon dioxide during the process of breathing. We all know that. Plants use this carbon dioxide for making their own food by the photosynthesis process. Animals also help in dispersal of seeds. Insects like butterfly, bees help flowers in pollination. That means they help to transfer the pollen grains from one flower to another. Plants also need animals for keeping a balance in the nature. For example, if human beings kill all tigers, no tiger will be left in the forest. The number of deers will increase in the absence of their predator. So what will be the result? The deers will eat all the plants and no plants will be left and they will starve eventually. A change in the population of any animals in the food chain will disturb the overall balance in the nature. That means we need all the organisms like the tigers. They are the deadliest animal, but still we conserve them or we protect them in the wildlife sanctuary and in national park because they are the part of the nature. So we must protect them in order to maintain the balance. Previously, we have learned the term interdependence. Let us learn some new terms. So, what do you mean by habitat? Have you heard about the term? Habitat is a place where plants and animals, they live. All right, that means the natural home or the environment of an animal or plant where it lives and grows. It is called its habitat. Can you tell me where we can find deers? Yes, they can be found in forest. That means forest is their habitat. So, different types of animals live at different places. Let us find out. Now look at the picture. This is the polar bear. And polar bear lives near the poles, which are very, very cold. So, it adapts itself to the environment. So, what is the meaning of adaptation? Adaptation is a special skill which helps an animal to survive and to do everything it needs to do. Alright, that's why it needs a thick coat or thick layer of fur to keep its body warm in order to survive in that freezing cold. I hope you all know about the cactus. It is the spiky plant and it is abundantly found in desert. Alright, so they live in deserts. That means deserts are their natural habitat. And cactus adapts itself according to environment in order to survive in the desert. It has long roots which help it to take water from the deep in the ground. Why so? Because of deserts are part of the land that is very dry, because of it receives low amount of rainfall. Alright, so that's why plant needs to adapt themselves according to the place they live in. And that particular place where they live in is known as the habitat. Next, we will learn about the environmental components. Our environment, it has basically two types of component. One is abiotic, another is the biotic components, or we say the biotic factors or abiotic factors. So what is the meaning of biotics? Bio means living. Alright, so living or once living organisms are known as the biotic factors or the biotic components. That means the dead body of plants and animals, they are also the biotic components. So what is the abiotic factors? A means not, and we have learned biotic means living. So abiotic means non-living. Let us learn the example. So biotic means living and abiotic factors mean non-living. As simple as that. So, plants, animals, fungi, bacteria, all of them are living. So, they are the biotic components of our environment. And non-living, water, sunlight, soil, air, temperature, all of them are non-living. So, they belong to the category of abiotic component. We all know that human activities disturb the environmental balance. Our Earth is the most precious planet in the solar system, because it has everything that living beings need for survival. Because on Earth, we can have water, air, sunlight and many more things that we need in day-to-day activities. Due to increase in our population, the demand for everything is increasing day by day. And we need more land to cultivate. That means to grow the crops. To build houses, we are cutting the trees to meet our demand, which has led to deforestation and also the soil erosion. We have learned in our previous chapter, natural calamities, that what are the consequences that we are facing due to the deforestation, global warming, drought, and many more. So, of course, we must not cut the trees unnecessarily. And we should plant more trees to prevent the soil erosion. Look at the picture here. The baby koala and its mother, they are homeless. Because we are cutting the trees for our own need and we are not even thinking about them. So first of all, we must protect the forest, the trees. Forest is the home to birds, insects and wild animals. They help to keep the environment clean by taking in carbon dioxide and releasing oxygen. The roots of trees hold the soil together, thus preventing the soil from being washed away. This reduces soil erosion. People also depend on forests for fuel, fodder, timber and leaf litter for manure preparations. Cutting down trees means taking away the natural habitat from the animals. I have already mentioned that. So we must protect the forest in order to maintain the harmony between animals and plants as well as with the human beings. We are familiar with the term afforestation. Since forests are so important for us, we must ensure that whenever a tree dies or it cut down, we must plant another tree. And special festivals are celebrated to educate and encourage people to plant more trees. For example, Bano Mahotsav. They are held at various places where trees are planted at the beginning of the rainy season. Also, national parks and sanctuaries have been created by the government to protect the forests. Next, we will learn about the Chipko movement. It is a type of satyagraha, that means non-violent resistance. This is mainly done through the act of hugging trees to protect them from being cut down. And in 1973, this kind of forest conservation movement started in India. This movement is known as the Chipko movement. It was initiated by Sundar Lal Bahuguna. Look at the picture. So people, they hugged the trees in order to protect them from being cut down. The World Environment Day is celebrated on 5th of June every year by the United Nations. We have discussed previously that government created national parks and wildlife sanctuaries in order to protect the animals. Due to human beings, many animals have become extinct or are on the verge of extinction. That means there will be no living members of that particular animal. So the government has now started protecting the forest and the animals by setting up national parks as well as the wildlife sanctuaries. Cutting of trees and poaching is not allowed in these areas. It is well protected, so the hunters cannot enter. In our country, there are many national parks and sanctuaries. For example, Jim Corbett National Park, which was established to protect tigers. It is named after the famous British hunter and the naturalist, Jim Corbett. There are several organizations who help to create the awareness and protect the wildlife. One of the most important organization is Worldwide Fund for Nature, or in short WWF, and this is the organization's symbol. It is an international organization that works to create awareness and protect the wildlife. It was set up to stop the degradation of the plant's natural environment and to build a future in which humans live in harmony with nature by conserving the world's biological diversity. That means they try to protect all the life form that can be found on Earth. They also ensure that the use of renewable natural resources is sustainable. That means they ensure that the use of renewable natural resources like wind or the solar energy are in limit. They set a limit for consumption of any kind of resources so that our future generations will be able to meet their needs as well. Next is promoting the reduction of pollution and wasteful consumption. If we use the natural resources in a limit, so we will be able to control or reduce the pollution as well. Last but not the least, our Earth is the only planet where life is present. So we all must join hands to protect it in every possible way. Remember that. So this is all for today. Read the chapter once. I will send you the question answer of this chapter. Thank you, students.